Hello, and welcome to this video on fillet weld measurements in the arc welding playlist. To start with, let me share the screen so you can follow along in this presentation. My name is Girish Kelkar, and I am a welding consultant working as WJM Technologies, which stands for Welding and Joining of Materials. Today, we're going to talk about fillet weld measurements. There are many fillet joints which are used in industry, and three of them are T-joints, lap joint, and corner joint. By some estimates, fillet welds account for up to 80% of all the arc welds that are made out there. Fillet welds can tolerate considerable fit-up variation. So one of the reasons why fillet welds are popular is they do not require perfect fit-up, and so you can use parts which are stamped and sheared. Fillet welds are also suitable for GMAW or MIG welding because deep penetration is not a requirement. So that is one of the reasons fillet welds made with MIG welding or GMAW are one of the most common welds out there in the automotive industry. Let's look at the concepts of weld interface and roots. On the schematic on the left shows a T-joint between two parts, and the parts are mating together along the weld interface. So that line is the weld interface. If you're going to be welding from the right over here, then the location where the two faces meet is called the theoretical weld root. If we actually make a weld over here, and let's say the weld section looks as shown on the right, obviously this is a schematic drawing, then the actual weld root is the deepest point of fusion along the weld interface. So this is the theoretical weld root, and this is the actual weld root. Oftentimes, I have seen people measure the weld root from the deepest point of the weld, but which is not correct. So the throat of the weld is the line drawn from the actual weld root to the weld face, not including the convex reinforcement, because the reinforcement does not immediately add value for the strength. So this red line would be the throat of the weld. In some situations, there can be multiple roots. So for example, if the two parts have a gap in between them, then there can be two roots, one on each side of the interface. And then we have two throats, and you have to make sure that the shortest of the throat meets the weld specification. In some situations where there might be a situation where the weld has not gone deep enough to fuse the theoretical root, here again, we are going to get two different roots and two different throats. And again, we are going to use the shorter of the two to make sure that meets specification. Keep in mind that fusion at the theoretical root may not be a requirement in a weld specification. So make sure you check the relevant specification that you're trying to meet for your application. Here is a cross-section of a real weld. We have part A and part B, and this is a T-junction and a fillet weld. You can see the actual root, and we have drawn a line from the actual root to the weld face, and that will be the throat of the weld. And then you have leg A measurement on the A side and the leg B on B side. So usually, typically, the leg length has to be 90% of the thinner of the two materials. So the leg length has to be more than 90% of the thickness of the thinner of the two materials. So this is the typical cross-section and the way of measuring the actual, locating the actual weld root and the leg. However, there can be some confusion over there as well. Here I'm showing you a cross-section on the right, where we are again seeing a fillet weld in a T-junction. But what we are noticing is the fusion is not very consistent or not there all the way to the toes of the weld. So there's a small section of the weld towards the toe of the region of the weld where we don't have fusion. So in that case, what is going to happen is we have two different measurements now. We have the leg length measurement, which assumes there is fusion all the way to the toe of the weld, and leg size measurement, which is what we are going to measure in cross-section. So the leg length measurement is what we are going to measure if we use fillet gauges and measure the weld externally, then that is called the leg length. When we measure the leg in cross section and we only include the length of the leg where we have good fusion, that is called leg size. So that is the difference between leg size and leg length. Keep in mind that the leg size has to meet the required specification. There's another source of confusion is in the terms of depth of fusion and penetration. Depth of fusion is how deep the fusion has gone into part A or part B. So in this case, this would be the depth of fusion in A, and this would be the depth of fusion in B. Usually the requirement is that the depth of fusion should be about 10%, at least at one location, 10% of the thickness of the thinner of the two components, at least at one location. Whereas penetration is the distance from the theoretical root to the actual root. So that's the difference between depth of fusion and penetration. Oftentimes I have found in measurements that people use interchangeably the terms penetration and depth of fusion. That also can cause a lot of confusion. Now, why do we measure the size of the weld? The reason why we measure the leg size and fusion and penetration and throat is we want to make sure that the weld we have made is actually going to meet this intended weld strength that the designer had planned for. However, there are situations where the actual weld strength may be different than what we are actually measuring, and for multiple reasons. It could be that the filler metal that we are adding may be stronger or weaker than the base metal. It could be that the heat affected zone might be stronger or weaker because of the welding heat. And in that case, the failure mode could be different. It could also be that the residual stresses in the weld affecting the fusion zone strength based on the weld profile, joint design, and material properties. So all of these components can contribute to having a weld strength which is different than what we think we measured. So while it is important to know how to accurately measure the weld size, it is also important for you to measure the weld strength by actual testing to make sure it actually meets the intended design strength. Thank you for your time. If you are interested in learning more about welding and joining, please subscribe to this YouTube channel, The Weld Nugget. Videos on other topics such as resistance welding, laser welding, metallurgy are also in the playlist on this channel. I'm looking forward to keeping in touch, and thank you once again.